Good morning, there we go. Now, good morning. It is a good morning. I'd like to welcome you all here to Brunswick First United Methodist Church, and it's so good to see you all this morning that we can come together as a family to worship our Lord. And I know that fall officially begins on September 22nd, but for me, in my mind, fall begins in October. So I've dug out my scarecrows and my pumpkins, and I've gotten our house decorated. And so now I'm just waiting for the cool weather. And I'm sure it's going to be coming this week. I can feel it in my bones. And, you know, while we may not get the changing of the leaves down here, you know, the marsh changes colors, and we have beautiful weather to enjoy. So I hope this will be a wonderful fall season for all of you. So on to church business. We have snack, supper, and MYF tonight beginning at 6 o'clock. And so, youth, if you'll come on back tonight, let's see what Shannon has in store for you. We have an SPR meeting tonight at 5 o'clock, and this meeting is not listed in the bulletin. So if you are on the SPR committee, if you can come back tonight so that we can wrap up our business, we're trying to get our budget set. We have family night supper on Wednesday beginning at 5:45, and I don't know if you guys looked at the back of the bulletin. At the menu, we're having oven-fried chicken, mac and cheese, steamed vegetables, biscuits, and brownies. Now, who doesn't want to come and have that for supper? So, y'all, if you can come, it's wonderful fellowship, wonderful food. Just, if you can, make your reservations by Monday at noon so that we can have an accurate head count. And we have, this is about my last time I'll be able to remind you about our church pictorial directory. The sign-up sheets are out in the narthex. The photographers will be here for the last time, October 16th through the 20th. So if you have not had your picture taken yet or you have not signed up for your appointment, you know, please do so, because we do have the directories for about 4 years, and you don't want to be left out. It's good to look through it and see, you know, everybody's picture in there and everything. So please, if you can, make those appointments. You can either sign up in the narthex or go to the church's website. And now let us open our hearts and minds as we prepare to worship.
Good morning. Our hymn of adoration is hymn number 529, How Firm a Foundation. From as far back as I can remember, the last line of the last stanza of this hymn has always been one that has come back to me no matter what's going on in my life. I'll always hear in my head, I'll never, no, never, no, never, three times. That to me made an impression when I was a child. So when we get here, when you get there, let's stand and sing that I'll never, never, never forsake you.
Singing, remain standing for our affirmation of faith, which is the Apostles' Creed, the traditional version. There is another version. It's found at 881 in the back of the hymnal for our visitors. Let us unite in this historic confession of our Christian faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please be seated for a moment, if you will. Do we have anybody who's a very first-time visitor in our church this morning? Anybody who's visiting with us for the very first time? If you do, we've got a gift bag for you, but I don't see any this morning. Today is World Communion Sunday, and so today we join our thoughts and our hearts and our minds with folks from literally around the world, millions and millions who have already taken communion today. And as the sun moves toward the west, there will be millions more and millions who will do it while we're doing it. So this is World Communion Sunday. Now, we'll receive a special offering at the altar today. If you would like to participate in the offering that we will send for World Communion Sunday, we're going to divide it in two today. We're going to give half toward a very special local mission project that we're working on, and then half of it will go toward World Communion. So if you choose to leave an offering at the rail this morning, it will go to two places. Now, there are a couple things I want to bring to your mind. First of all, let me ask you this. How many have already had your pictures made for the pictorial directory? Okay, about half. Now, the other half of you, how many of you have signed up for pictorial directory? Okay, now I would like to ask, but I don't want to put you on the spot, so I'm not going to ask you to raise your hands. If you haven't had your picture made or haven't signed up for it, we want you to do that. And that is a very easy process. You can do it two ways. You can either do it physically down in the narthex or down in the welcome center on the sheets, or you can go online at the website and you can sign up. So please do that. You'll be getting a robocall this week. I think this week or next week. I'm not sure which. I've got to look at the schedule. But one of those automated calls that it will be me, and I'll be reminding you to get your picture made. So keep that in mind. Today, at 4 o'clock, our bishop will be in our district to have Bishop's Hour for the Waycross District, and I've got to apologize to him for having a PPR at 5 o'clock today when the Bishop's Hour is at 4, but the bishop owes me. Let me tell you why. We have had put on the list, which I've done in every district that I've served, and had all of our bishops preach for me in our local churches, starting with Leslie, literally, and all the way, all the other churches that we've had. Now, Bishop King was scheduled to come here on April the 28th of next year. However, Benji Varnell, our superintendent, sent me an email this week, and he said Bishop King has canceled all of his spring, winter and spring preaching appointments all over the conference. So he won't be with us on April the 28th, but we're still at the top of the list for whenever the bishop becomes available again. I think he's going to be taking a sabbatical or something like that. So anyway, we'll let you know about that when it happens in the future. Now, Hudson Glenn Clements, I hope you got the email, was born this week. Five of our seven babies are here, and we're so excited. So Hudson Glenn with one N, he's named after a grandfather, and that's Brian and Lacey Clements. So we want to say congratulations to them. And there are a couple other things, concerns that we'll lift up to you during prayer time. But we're glad that you're here. We want you to greet somebody. Now, if you will, stand and turn to your neighbor and say, the Georgia players missed the bus going to South Carolina to the game last. They just didn't get on the bus. Stand and greet someone and tell them you're glad to see them this morning.
And now if you can register your attendance on the pad on the end of your pew, and when it comes back, make sure you look it over so that we know each other by name. The altar flowers today are given by Margaret and Jay Harris in loving memory of their son, David. And Jim already told us about Lacey Clements and Hudson and Glenn Clements. At Sears Manor for rehab is Gilda Haythorne. She's in room 207. And please continue to pray for our service personnel, Scotty Bennett, John Patrick Thornton, Brian Hayes, Eric Friedrich, Charles Wells, A.J. Schaefer, and Lauren Maynard, and our missionaries in the field, the Lovelace, Great House, Shirouse, and Trousdale families. And we would like to offer Christian love and sympathy to Ned Cash and family in the death of Mary Cash on October the 3rd. And also a memorial service has been planned for Ed Blanton. It'll be October 13th in the sanctuary on Saturday, October 13th at 11 o'clock. Do we have other prayer concerns? Ed Jacob, thank you. Okay, your parents, thank you. Jane and Bruce Faircloth. My parents, my dad's not doing well, so my mom and dad, Tom and Janet McDonald.
We do want to remember Missy's father in our prayers, and then George Ingram's sister-in-law passed away, and we want to remember that family in our prayers. Now, some of you have heard the word about Scott Truluck's father being lost during hunting expedition this weekend at their cabin outside of Athens, Georgia, but we got a text from Scott this morning that his father had been found. And Kevin Diestel has a picture on his iPhone of the crowd that assembled early this morning, about 300 folks to go and search because Scott's father's been missing for a couple of days. But and Scott responded to Kevin on his phone. He said, "Praise God, my father's been found alive." So I know that he'll need your prayers as he recovers from whatever experiences he had to have during the two nights that he was missing. And then Miss Jane is very concerned about Bruce Faircloth. Bruce has been in the hospital this week, and we need to keep him in our prayers and going to have a procedure done this week. So please keep him in your prayers. And as Missy mentioned, Mary Cash's family, we had her funeral service in here yesterday morning at 11 o'clock, and just keep Mr. Ned and all of their family in your prayers. So if you will, let's go to the Lord in prayer at this time, and we'll take a few moments to lift up our own requests individually before the Lord, and then we'll join our hearts together in prayer. So will you pray with me? Father God, as we gather together this morning, we realize that on one hand we have some things that we're grateful for and thankful for. We thank you that Scott's father was found, and we're thankful that he is alive this morning. And Lord, we realize too that there are many people in our midst who have special needs and special requests, and we lift them up before the throne this morning. We thank you for Mary's family, Mary Cash's family. We thank you for her contributions to the life of this church and the life of this community, the life that she and Ned shared together, and all of their family. And Lord, we just pray your blessing upon them. We pray that you will bless them with good memories. We pray that you would bless them during this time when they need your comforting presence. Just be near to them, Lord. And we pray for George Ingram's sister-in-law's family. We just ask for the presence of your Holy Spirit. The last verse of the hymn, "How Firm a Foundation," were lifted up this morning. Lord, you also promised never to leave us or forsake us, and to constantly be with us, that when the Holy Spirit of God would come, that he would be our comforter. And so we pray for that comforting presence. We pray for that healing presence. Lord, we thank you for the ways that we have heard about this week, where God has mercifully worked in situations. And we have sensed your hand of mercy and grace, and we just ask, Father, that for those who are in need, that they might lift their hearts before the throne of heaven. And Father, that you would indeed mercifully reach down and touch them, we pray. Now, Father, we pray for those situations that are going on around the world. We pray, Father, for the situation between Turkey and Syria this morning. We know that this situation has dire potential to it, and we just ask for your presence. We ask for wisdom for our leaders. We ask for wisdom for our Congress. Lord, we pray that you would give wisdom if men are willing to ask for it. Lord, you promised to give it. We realize that promise is in the Word of God. And so, Lord, we pray that you would intervene in situations and help us, Father, to do the best of our ability to keep peace in this world, we pray. Lord, we ask for your presence personally. Meet each of us this morning at the point of our need. We thank you for men and women who are serving this country. We thank you for men and women who are serving the church, who are serving the cause of the kingdom. As our bishop comes to Strickland Auditorium this afternoon, we just ask for the peace of your presence. We pray for the power of his message as it goes forth. Now, Father, we commit this service into your hands. We pray for your presence as we join our hearts and our minds and our spirits with those around the world who are coming to the Lord's table today. We pray these things in the name of Jesus, who taught us prayer by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, and thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Now, as the ushers prepare to come forward to receive our act of worship through our giving, we remind you again of what we've mentioned about the communion offering that will be left at the altar. And I hope that you received the email this week. You have done incredibly well this past year, and I pray that you'll keep it up. I pray that our faithful giving will lead us to a wonderful fourth quarter, especially on this Sunday, when we look forward to the next five Sundays, which will begin our ministry, mission, and stewardship campaign in the life of our church. And if you haven't picked up Bishop Snazy's book yet, I trust that you'll do that. That's in the Welcome Center, and it's available for you to take home. The readings begin tomorrow. So join us. The next five Sundays will be sermons based on the five practices of fruitful congregations, and we'll hear from Bishop Snazy in a moment. Let's join our hearts together as we ask God's blessing upon our giving. Father, we come in this act of worship to bring our tithes and our offerings into the Lord's storehouse. Bless them for the sake of the kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Please be seated. We're not going to be reading a scripture this morning, but rather as a part of the communion challenge and meditation to prepare our hearts to come to the Lord's table on this World Communion Sunday, we have an introductory video that we're going to watch, about a 5-minute video that is from Bishop Snazy. He was elected bishop out of the Missouri Annual Conference and has been a wonderful leader in the church concerning church growth, church development, and I think that you're going to appreciate the challenge. This will be the introduction to the 5 Sundays that we'll have following this one. So please watch Bishop Snazy's challenge.
Radical hospitality, passionate worship, intentional faith development, risk-taking mission and service, extravagant generosity. These are the practices of vibrant, growing, fruitful congregations. I'm Robert Schnazy, author of 5 Practices of Fruitful Congregations, and I'm thrilled that your congregation is taking part in a wonderful conversation about the mission and purpose of the church. The purpose of the church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. But how do we do that? The most visible way God knits people into the community of Christ and draws people into relationship with God is through congregations. Congregations that fulfill the ministry of Christ in the world. Congregations that repeat and deepen and learn and grow, improve and extend on these 5 basic practices. These are the fundamental activities that are so critical to the mission of the church that failure to perform them in an exemplary way leads to congregational decline and deterioration. Here's how the 5 practices work together in the mission of the church. First, there's radical hospitality. Congregations offer the invitation and embrace of Jesus Christ, the gracious welcome that creates genuine belonging, that brings people together into Christian community. And once someone belongs to the Christian community, it's in worship that is alive and passionate and authentic, that God works to shape the hearts and minds of people, helping us see the world through God's eyes and creating in us an even greater desire to grow closer to God, a desire to learn more. And that leads us to this desire to enter into learning and community, intentional faith development. Intentional faith development refers to those Bible studies and Sunday school classes and small group experiences where we mature in the faith, where we learn about joy and peace and grace and forgiveness and those elements that we can't learn by ourselves. And we can't deepen our faith very much without us sensing in ourselves a call of God to make a difference in the lives of other people. And this takes us to risk-taking mission and service. These are the ministries that churches do to make a difference in the lives of others, whether or not those people ever become part of the church. And as we mature in faith, we grow also in generosity, and we give back just as we have received to strengthen the church, the ministry, and the body of Christ so that more people now and in the future can receive what we have received, and that's the extravagant generosity. Radical hospitality, passionate worship, intentional faith development, risk-taking mission and service, extravagant generosity. These words are powerful and edgy and provocative. They're dangerous and irresistible and contagious, and they can change you, and they can change your church. The practices are really pretty basic. Hospitality is what a church does about inviting people, evangelism, and then worship, and Christian education is intentional faith development, and there's mission and generosity or stewardship. But it's the adjectives that make these words come alive, because it's the adjectives of radical and passionate and intentional and risk-taking and extravagant that pulls us out of ourselves and stretches us and causes us to ask ourselves, how are we doing as a church, and how can we do better, and how are we doing as Christian disciples, and what may God be expecting of us? I believe that Jesus' ministry was radical and passionate and intentional and risk-taking and extravagant. Now, these are practices, not steps, not qualities of a church that some churches have and some don't. They're not phases that once we get that done, we can move on to something else. These are practices that we have to learn and deepen and repeat and improve upon constantly. I think of the example of baseball when I think of practices. If you look at Little Leaguers' practice, they scoop up grounders, they catch pop-up flies, they practice batting. And then you look at the big leaguers, those who are getting paid zillions of dollars and are at the height of their careers, and they do exactly the same things when they practice. They practice batting, they practice scooping up grounders and catching pop-ups. That's the way practices are. We never finish one and say, now we've got that done, and we don't have to focus on that anymore. These practices are behaviors that congregations learn and grow and improve upon. They are applicable to small churches, large churches, medium-sized churches, urban, rural, suburban, and they apply to your congregation as well. During these next several weeks, you're going to have this wonderful opportunity to focus on the purpose of the church and to reinvigorate the ministries of your church. The purpose of this time together is to take these words beyond conversations between pastor and church leaders and take them into the worship services and classes and homes of every church member to embed them into the fabric of your congregation. You'll be having a church-wide, in-depth conversation about the purpose of the church, the why of congregational life. I hope that one of the results of this is that you develop a unifying common language that helps people understand the tasks of Christian discipleship. That this is a conversation that will push deeper and shift culture and reshape attitudes and spark creativity. The whole church will be praying together and learning together and growing together in ministry. My prayer is that your church can experience a reinvigorated sense of purpose and connection to God and to the ministry of Jesus Christ. I thank you for your love of the church and for your love of Christ and for your leadership in these moments. Enter this time prayerfully, allowing the Spirit of God to pervade the lives of the members of your congregation so that through you the ministry of Jesus Christ can become fruitful, can blossom.
Things that we need to celebrate with regard to the worldwide church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, locally, we need to rejoice in the fact that at the 8:45 service this morning, we received the Walter Lee family into the life of our church. So Walter and Joni and Hannah will be members, and Duncan and Dixie will go on a preparatory role. And the Lord adds to the church something that you need to be aware of. Mainstream press has not picked this up like they did when his life was threatened, but Pastor Joseph, the Iranian evangelical Protestant pastor in Baghdad, who had been arrested and was threatened with beheading, has been freed and is home. And this morning, I'm sure it's the case, I'm not absolutely certain, but I believe that it is, that if that man had anything to do with his church this morning, he was back in his own pulpit, and he was serving communion to his congregation. We prayed for Pastor Joseph months ago, and yet no one seems to be much aware. I received an email from someone who lives in another state, and I rejoice in the fact that he's been released, and he's back with his three children and his wife and in his own church this morning. Now, what comes to your mind when you heard Bishop Snazy use the word church? What is the picture that you have? Is it this building? Is it another building somewhere? Is it your experiences? The picture that comes to my mind of the church is a complicated one because it encompasses many states. Yes, my parents made me go to church, but there wasn't any making to it. In my family, when I grew up and Sunday morning came, there just wasn't another alternative. You see, we were going to church. And we came to expect it. We came to expect getting ready for church on Saturday night so that we could be at Sunday school and in church. And my church experience, I have wonderful church experiences from everywhere from Pennsylvania to Florida to Kentucky to Virginia during a time when my folks were in Virginia and, of course, Georgia. And when I think of the church, I have multiple pictures. And I can think of thousands, literally, of people who influenced my life. One of my very favorite pictures, however, of the church is when I was in junior high school. My father was pastoring in Pennsylvania, and we were in a church where the junior high boys' Sunday school class, now back then it was junior high school, and some of you went to junior high school. It's middle school now, includes sixth grade. But in junior high, the junior high boys' class met in the belfry of the church. Now, the belfry was the little room in the back corner outside the narthex, just in the narthex outside of the sanctuary, where the bell hung, the bell rope hung down. And us young boys would fight to get to ring the bell before church and after church. You see, the church bells rang at 11 o'clock, and then they rang at 12 o'clock or whenever my daddy was done preaching. And the boys would fight, had a great big old 2-inch hemp rope that hung from the bell way up in the tower, and you had to pull it several times, skinny little boys. Yes, I was a skinny little boy. You had to pull that thing up and down and up and down, and finally it let out that great peal from the bell, and if you hung on to that rope, it would pick you up about 6 feet in the air, and it was fun. But the thing that I remember most about the belfry is our Sunday school class. There were five of us in that class, including the teacher, Junior Miles. And you see, it was just a tiny little room. It wasn't much bigger than this area right here. And there were six chairs in there. And when all of us were in Sunday school class, our knees touched. And I remember our Sunday school lessons. I remember Junior Miles' heart. And I remember the guidance that he tried to give some young boys. I don't remember trying to act up. I didn't have a choice. I don't remember trying to do crazy things. We were in Sunday school to learn about the Lord. And Junior was there to share the Lord with us. Now, here's what I like about the picture of the church and that little belfry and our junior high Sunday school boys class. You see, if somebody was gone, then we had room to spread out a little bit, and our knees didn't touch. If there were only four boys there, or three boys there, we knew somebody was missing. And we wanted to know why. And I like that picture of the church. The church is an incredible institution. George Barna is a man who keeps his finger on the pulse of the church in America. The Barna Research Group polls churches, no political polling. Well, he might poll for political views concerning various theological viewpoints, but he keeps his finger on the pulse of the church. And George Barna made this statement. Now, he's written several books, and I forget exactly which book this came from. In fact, I've got another Barna quote from The Second Coming of the Church, where in a chapter he calls the unsinkable church that I like, and I'll share with you in a moment. But in this particular research, Barna said this. He said, culture reinvents itself every 5 to 8 years. American culture reinvents itself every 5 to 8 years. The church reinvents itself every 35 to 40 years. The church, on average, is 75 to 80 years behind culture. Now, that can give us some things to chew on. There are a lot of things that we can unpack in that research and in that statement. During the next 5 weeks, we are going to be challenged in how we think about the church. You see, last year's campaign was very intensely interested in you beginning a spiritual journey, if you hadn't, that called upon your commitment and your dedication to the things of the kingdom of God. In this particular study, from Bishop Snazy's point of view, and we'll begin next week with the topic radical hospitality, and I'm going to challenge you personally with some things about radical hospitality that I'll bet nobody's ever said to you before, and I hope that you'll be here next week for it. But we're going to be challenged to think in new ways about what and who the church is. And I can imagine that there are people that would say, well, I don't want culture influencing my church. And yet, you know what? Culture has already influenced every single one of us in this room. Do you have indoor plumbing? I haven't seen anybody flushing their cell phones, unless you get really mad at it. We're the products of our culture. Of course we enjoy culture. Every one of us in this room wants to dress decently. And we buy clothes that we think help us to fit in our culture. Cars we drive, houses we live in, the furniture that we buy for ourselves. Oh my. We are the products of our culture. Why does the church lag behind? Now, I want to present to you this morning as we prepare our hearts. Well, let me give you this other Barna quote. Barna said in the second coming of the church, in the Unsinkable Church chapter, he said, "The church must learn to participate, not merely react." Too often we react rather than participating. I want to give you two pictures of the church this morning as we prepare our hearts to take communion. Two pictures of the church. The first picture of the church that I want to give you comes from the very beginning, from its infancy. A day and a time when 10 men are on a seashore. You see, they've experienced the resurrection. They were there and they saw him. And they heard him say to Thomas, you've doubted, but blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. And here, Thomas, put your finger into my hand and your hand into my side where the spear went. There's so much about that challenge to test the Lord that we need to learn as Christians. I can see him standing in front of some of you saying, "Try me." Just like he said to the prophet Malachi, tell the children of Israel, "Try me. Try my word and see if it doesn't work for you. Try this thing of tithing and see if it doesn't reap benefits in your life. Try this thing called the offering. Try it. Put your finger in the hole where the nail went. See how real it is. Put your hand in my side where the spear went." Here's a group of men who have seen this, and they don't quite know what to do with it. So they do two things. They give up and they go back. I've seen a lot of Christians start down the road and they give up and they turn back. They give up good things that God had for them, and they go back to what they know. Peter said, "I'm going fishing." They got in the boat, fished all night, didn't catch anything. Jesus called to them from the shore, "Children, have you caught anything?" Here's the church in its infancy, a group of men who are waiting. They're not sure what they're waiting on. They're willing to take a little direction here. Cast the net on the other side of the boat, and then they couldn't drag it in, so it was so full. And I want you to see this particular demonstration of the power of God. I think the church in its infancy needs some apparent demonstration of God's power. Now, we're weak, mature. We're very immature if we expect that. Jesus said, "This generation wants a sign." Do you need a sign? Do you need God somehow to demonstrate dramatically his power for you to begin doing the things he wants you to do? Oh, you better be careful. I would just say that from spiritual experience. You better be careful. Here's a group of men who see, and I want you to get this picture. Jesus has already prepared fish on the coals for their breakfast. And yet he says to them, "Bring the fish you've caught." Isn't that interesting? He doesn't need it for their breakfast. You can read it in John 21. He's already prepared the fish on the fire. It's there. It's their breakfast. "Come and eat. By the way, bring the fish you caught." And they couldn't get it to, they got it to shore and the net didn't break, and that was a miracle in itself. And you see, Jesus was saying to them the thing that we looked at in the garage at the picnic a couple of weeks ago. If I want you to be fishermen, I'll help you to be fishermen. I don't want you to be fishermen. I want you to become fishers of men. That's in Mark's gospel, the first chapter. Follow me, and I will help you become. We are a church that is becoming the church that God wants us to be. That's what we're going to look at during the next 5 weeks. These are characteristics of fruitful congregations. And we want to become. We are in some ways, but we want to become the church, a fruitful congregation that God wants us to be. Now I want to take you to the second picture of the church, and I want you to hear this passage, this challenge. This is Paul writing to the churches of Thessalonica. Now this is a church that's experienced the goodness of God, and it's begun to grow, and it's reaching out. And here's what Paul says to them. He says, I give thanks to God always for you all. Some people say Paul was a southerner. Give thanks to God for you all, making mention of you in our prayers, remembering without ceasing your work of faith. Listen to these things. It's great to take these individually and unpack them one by one because it says so much to us. This church, remembering without ceasing your work of faith, your labor of love, and your patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ, in the sight of our God and Father, knowing, beloved, your election by God. For our gospel did not come to you in word only. You see, sometimes I think today that the church is hearing the word only and not living it, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and in much assurance, as you know what kind of men we were among you for your sake. Now, he's bragging there spiritually. They lived good lives, exemplary lives among the churches of Thessalonica. And you became followers of us and of the Lord, having received the word in much affliction with joy and in the Holy Spirit, so that you became examples to all in Macedonia and Achaia who believe. I wonder if people look at Brunswick First Methodist Church and say, that's a church whose members example the love of God among themselves, others in the community. For from you the word of the Lord has sounded forth, not only in Macedonia and in Achaia, but also in every place. Your faith toward God has gone out, so that we really don't need to say anything. But listen to this. For they themselves declare concerning us what manner of entry we had to you, and how you did two things: how you turned to God from idols to serve the living and true God, and how you wait for his Son from heaven. Oh my. That we might be the church in today's world. The church that examples the living God, the true God, and loves one another. And that we are here this morning to participate in this service, waiting on this same Jesus that you've seen go up to heaven. He's going to come back again. Are you really waiting for him? Are you really looking for him? This is a mark of the church, the true church. The word of God says that on the night that he was betrayed, Jesus took bread and broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, this is my body, which is broken for you. And when you do this, remember that you are becoming fishers of men. And the word says that after supper he took the cup and he passed it to his disciples. And he said, drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you do this, remember that you are becoming the church. Lord Jesus Christ. Father God, we eat this bread and drink this cup, remembering your love. remembering that you are making us and that we are becoming. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to serve the servers here, then the ushers will give you direction to come to the Lord's table. And I invite you to leave an offering at the Lord's table for Worldwide Communion Sunday. Father God, we live, believe, hope, and pray for your coming in our lives, in the church, and in the world. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we're grateful for one who would give and give and give. Help us first to receive and then to be willing to give. In Jesus' name, amen. God, for your rich bounty, blessing, and goodness. We give you thanks. May we be willing to share from the same hand. In Christ's name. God, help us to be like those men who waited, who followed directions and went to wait for the Spirit of God to come upon them. Lord, then the church became the church in power and in might. We want to be your church in this community. In Jesus' name, amen. Father, we're grateful that we have this hope within us that purifies us, that hope of waiting upon the one who will come, who will return in the same manner as he went. Help us to watch and wait in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Father, we thank you for love that fills us and that moves us forward in the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, will you stay here with me? Okay, I'm going to ask now, as this table is dismissed, if those who are going to serve our homebound communion, if they will come forward at this time and kneel at the altar, and we'll serve our homebound communion stewards. Now, we'd like to read out to you the names of those who are going to receive homebound communion. I love the extension of this that goes out, and this is exactly what Paul was talking about, the churches of Thessalonica, that reaching out in the community, and that their reputation was known. But these of ours will receive communion from these who are kneeling here today: Bruce and Jane Faircloth, Wayne and Tommy Wilson, Nan Heist, Gilda Haythorne, Augusta Carruth, Hazel Fouché, Christine Brizendine, Martha Irwin, and Georgia Clements. And I'm grateful for these who kneel here today to be willing to take communion into the home. So we're going to anoint them and pray for them together and ask God's blessing upon their ministry. Lord, we thank you for the way that the church reaches out. And as we have already noted, the church around the world has knelt at the Lord's table today. And my, how the heart of God must be gladdened at the sight of men and women and boys and girls around the world taking communion together. And Father, join our hearts, join our minds, join our mission together as we lift up the cause of Christ and as we lift up the cross of Christ. Lord, help us to be powerful about it and consistent about it and loving about it, so that others will be drawn to the truth that we know and love, so that others will be drawn to the Christ that we love and serve. Father, we thank you for these who are willing to go into homes and to carry communion, and we know that there are those who so look forward to it, who depend upon it as a part of their connection to their local church. We just ask your blessing upon them as they reach out and as they touch other lives, and may through the sacrament that is offered, Father, there be a communion with God Almighty through the presence of the Holy Spirit, and we pray these things in Jesus' name, amen. Okay, if you will, let's stand together, and we're going to sing together in closing, and as a benediction, two verses of Amazing Grace, How Sweet the Sound. receive this benediction. Lord, as we have celebrated your table in love and in peace and in accord in this place, Father, we remember today that there's a church under persecution that celebrated the Lord's communion behind locked doors, that celebrated, Father, in fear of their lives. We give you thanks for them, Lord, and we pray for an increase in their number. We pray for the spread of the truth of Jesus in this world. Help us to be about it. We pray in thy name.